Good evening. I'm sorry to see that they scheduled the lecture in the night of a wedding. Last time it was people all the way to the end of this hallway, and today people rather go to the wedding. It's obvious. I wish I knew. I wouldn't agree to make the lecture. And plus, I'm going to change my whole subject because I was keeping a special subject for tonight, so I'm going to speak about something else. We see, basically, that if we review what's happening now in the world, we don't have to be a genius to realize that everything is a preparation for the final step that HaKadosh Baruch Hu is preparing us for. The world is continuing to be hypocrite as usual. When one Palestinian gets killed in Israel, for 1 week you don't stop to hear about it everywhere. But when 2,000 Syrian citizens getting bombed with helicopters and bombs are falling on their heads, nobody makes a beep. Nobody really cares about them. Nobody really cared that Arab dies. They are dancing in hidden rooms, you know. But they hate the Jews so much, so that's become an issue. Once the Jews are the one who protecting themselves, the world is going crazy. When Arabs kill Arabs, nobody cares. If the Arab will kill 1 million citizens, will be equal to the Israeli army killing 10 Palestinians. Why? Because it's the Jews. And this is exactly how the Prophet was preparing us for this time. The Prophet is preparing us that the whole world will be united together, and they all go in against Yerushalayim, against Jerusalem. It's not only a war that will take place against Israel. The Jews that are in different parts of the world, they're going to feel it. We were asked by this nice lady here, you know, to make the shiur for Rabbi Shalom Mordechai Rubashkin, that according to what they blaming him for, every other American guy will get probably 4 or 5 years in prison if he found guilty. I'm not even talking about guilty or not guilty here, but when it's a Jew, it's 27 years in prison to make sure he'll die there, that he'll never come out. That's the whole thing. If it would be 40, it would become 37 years. If it would be 30, it would become 50 years. The idea is just to make sure he doesn't come out of there. Same thing Pollard. Jonathan Pollard. The information that he gave the best friend of America. Nothing of that was ever taken actions against America. He didn't jeopardize America. Nobody had any intention to do anything bad to America here. And he's already 30 years in prison. You know? And his father is dying now. He's 90-something years old. He's mamash momentarily, they don't know what's going to be. He's begging to see his father for 10 minutes. And nobody agree. No one will ever get such treatment, you understand? And this is in a country that announced that he's the best friend of the Jews. You understand? Just in case you didn't realize, United States, they claim, I don't know, Hashem knows the truth. They claim that they are the best friends of Israel. But in reality, if you look at the last 30 years, 35 years, since Jimmy Carter until now, they are made us more damage, perhaps, than anybody in history ever made us. I mean, almost 80% of Israel was given to the enemies because of them. If they didn't want, it wouldn't happen. Because after all, they control the United Nations, they control all the votes. They continue to do whatever they want. Whatever they want to do in Afghanistan, they do. Nobody makes a beep. Whatever they want to do in Iraq, they do. Now in Libya, nobody even care. If they wanted Israel to be full without giving an inch, that would happen. They force us to give Sinai many of the cities. They force us to take all the settlers out of Gaza Strip, all these areas, to take Jews out of their homes. They don't get the point that every time they make the Jews give up, HaKadosh Baruch Hu punish them with horrible natural disasters. More than 1,000 Americans died in the hurricanes. The Christian religious people in America, they know it. They say it. They say that God is punishing us for going against Israel. But apparently in politics, politics and religion not always go together. This is the situation right now. We continue to see all these hypocrites that speak and hug and cheer for Israel, and then just behind our back continue to bury us deeper and deeper. And what's the whole point here that I'm making? That HaKadosh Baruch Hu is bringing us to a point that we have to understand that we have no one to trust beside Him. If we trust Him and someone else, it's already a very big problem. If we get to the point that we cannot trust the United States, we cannot trust the British or the French or any one of them, we cannot trust the Israeli army, even though they do their best to defend us, but nothing is in their hand. When HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants them to win, they win. When He wants them to be frozen, they are frozen. When He wanted them to win, miracles like never before were seen. When He wanted them to lose, 3,000 Hezbollah terrorists won against supposedly the best army in the Middle East, if you remember that war. So it's all what HaKadosh Baruch Hu wants. A big sin for us is to continue to trust people to save us. אל תפתחו בנדיבים בבן אדם שאין לו תשועה, תצא רוחו ישוב לאדמתו. Don't trust people, as generous as they may be. Their spirit comes out and they return right into the ground. The worms will end up eating them. If you have hope in people, the people will save us as individual, as a nation, as a country, it doesn't matter. Once we have hopes in other people, we are paying the price. It's not getting better. Hashem says, okay, you trust the Americans to save you? Americans, you'll be in their hands. They help once, three times they bury you. They help again, they bury you twice after. And that's what's happening. I don't know if you're familiar with Israel geography. Sinai, what we give Egypt with the fake peace, fake, 100% fake, because there was no war yet. When it's going to be a massive war in the Middle East, they will take a part in it. It's no peace. So it wasn't for nothing. It's more than two-thirds of Israel. Look at the map. The part what they gave them, it's two-thirds of what Israel was. Two-thirds. Imagine giving two-thirds of America to Russia, just that they promised not to bomb America ever, like you trust the world or something. Two-thirds of America to give them. What would happen here? Riots on the street. They'll spill the blood of the president in every corner here. Who would ever let him leave a minute after? But it happened, and now it happened again, and it's going to happen again. It soon gets to a point that the width of Israel will be 11 kilometers, 8 miles from here to Main Street. That's what it's going to be. The size of, from one side, from Jordan, the country Jordan, to the ocean, to the Middle Eastern Ocean, it's going to be like from here to Main Street. Huh? An hour walk. An hour walk. You can walk from one side of Israel to the other, 1 hour. Right? You understand? This is what's going on right now. Everything, it's in Parashat Bechukotai. Where does it say it? Ve'ne'esaftem el arechem. You're going to shrink into your cities and give up and shave another piece and shave another piece and shave another piece. Why is it? There's a list of reasons. Why is it? You don't follow me. You don't keep your promise to me. You don't keep the covenant. What's going to happen? That's what's happening. That's what's happening. If you follow it, nobody can touch you. I'll do everything for you. You don't make peace with me, you cannot make peace with any one of your enemies. And this is what's going on right now, and it's very sad. Eventually, unfortunately, in Israel we have a say, what doesn't come through the head, comes through the legs. Which means you don't learn in an easy way, you learn in a hard way, no problem. You know, this is a military statement. When you join the Israeli army, you still have your long hair. It takes a few hours to realize where you came. At the beginning, you think it's going to be, the nice teenage years of your life. So right away, they make you realize where you came to. Well, they shave your head off, this, that. The next thing, they treat you like a dog. And you cannot make a beep. They make you clean some bathrooms that were not clean for a month. And then you see the food that they give you. and you see how long you have to get ready in the morning, within a day you become an adult. They don't give you that much time to mature. You come a little teenage, the next day already very mature, you can be a grandfather already. Yeah, you have no choice. You run a tank, you're in charge of an F-16, F-15, $50 million in your signature within a month or two. That's it. You mature. They force you to mature right away. You know what happened to a baby that you force him to mature? It's a problem. So you take these kids, you force them to mature, and what happened after? You see, you look at the situation right now and you see what's happening. They grow with this thinking, we are the best, we know the best, we are the best fighters. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, no, my friend, it's not going to work that way. So in Israel, they teach you like this. In the first day of training, your commander is saying to you, you see that tree over there? You have 60 seconds to go, touch it, and come back and bring me a few leaves to make sure you touched it. 60 seconds, go. You came after 63 seconds. Now you begin to suffer. Up and down in 100 degrees. And they torture you like this. And they say, now let's try again. And of course you fail again because now you're more tired. And like this all night. And you keep screaming. What doesn't come through the head, come through the legs. If I would understand it in the first time, I wouldn't have to be running here all night. And then you think they let you go to sleep, 2 o'clock. Finally I can sleep. Of course you don't have time to take a shower, you sleep with your clothes. Right away 5 minutes later, you really think you're going to sleep? The night is only beginning. Let's go. That's what's going on. And what happened? If you messed up, they make everybody suffer with you. All the other soldiers. Why? To make them hate you. Because if they run at 2 o'clock at night and he scream, you know why you're all running? Because Moshe didn't make it on time. He thinks I'm joking. So tonight we're all going to run to make Moshe understand. And what happened to Moshe? They break his back after that. What do you think? You understand? This is the mentality, everything against Hashem. Everything. The army, humiliating people. Everything that is based on a lie cannot survive. Everything is rotten. How the country started. What did they want to do? They want to make Israel like London, Paris, and New York. That was their goal. When they started to speak about religion, all the Zionist communists started to scream, no, we're not interested to bring the exile into here. We want to make it like London and Paris. Like the coffee shops, you know, people with their hair, gel in their hair. Like the Goyim, like in the movies. What do we need now, all these Hasidim and Yemenites with their beards and peor? We don't need them over here. We get some of them a little bit. We'll convert them to be one of us. We'll give them a red card, make them communists, take off their peot, shave their beard, give them a job to work on Shabbat. That was the plan. How many years this lie can survive? How many years? It's collapsing now. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu makes sure that we hear every day how our enemies are saying these things face directly to us. The Zionist lie cannot survive. They will not. They are dying. They are bankrupt. A little bit more and we're taking over. We hear it every day from Iran, from the Palestinians. If you read the Hamas, they have a website. If you read how when they opened the Hamas, what they wrote about the Jews, how they betrayed God and they went against the Torah, you won't believe. They write over there, Yimach Shimo di Sheikh Yassin, the murderer, the despicable murderer, they write in the agreement, in the foundation of the Hamas, our job is to teach them a lesson that they left God. HaKadosh Baruch Hu make it so clear to us. And we're still blind. We don't see. That's why we pay and again and again and again. And nothing, nobody learned. What doesn't come through the head, in the end comes through the feet. You know what it means, come through the feet? The prophet says, if people will continue like this, it will be time everyone will bow down on their knees like crazy, mishugi, screaming on the street, help! Help! Doesn't matter, rich, poor, educated, college degree, no college degree. People will run crazy in the streets like happened now in the Arab countries. What do you think happening right now? Thousands running to Turkey. They left their homes, left everything they have, left their jewelry, left their rugs, left their everything they own. They left and they ran with their children and some bags in a desert somewhere in Syria, trying, hoping they can make it to some camp in Turkey and stay there for a month without shower, without anything. You understand? Everything HaKadosh Baruch Hu does to teach the Jews a lesson. Every tragedy happened in the world happened, the Gemara say, for the nation of Israel. For us to see what can happen. If we learn the point, we don't need, God forbid, to experience it. A smart person is a person who learns from other people's experience. He doesn't wait until it comes to him. If he waits that it comes to him, if he waits until it comes to him, it's already too late. You saw somebody made that mistake, the price that he paid, and you don't repeat the same mistake. And this is what brings me to yesterday's parasha. Ba'alotcha, parashat ba'alotcha. If you read the parasha, if you went to shul, if you understand what you read, we have something incredible. I'm much hard to believe. In a million years, I don't think I'm going to get it. I read all the commentaries, whatever they say about it. Bottom line, the mind cannot digest something like this. What is it? The parasha speaks about two most common sins that a Jew can do in his life, that the price for these sins is terrible, tremendous. There is, it's hard to imagine a worse punishment for any other sin than these two. What is it? The sin of the mouth. I just say two. Two sins can be done with the mouth. Two problems. Maybe the word sin is a little bit not the proper word. There are two problems that come from the mouth. The Torah says, Shomer piv hulshono, shomer mitzarot nafsho. Someone who watches his mouth and his tongue, he's watching his soul from problems, from trouble. Why the Torah uses a double language? Shomer piv, watch his mouth, and his tongue. Isn't it the same? Watch your mouth, we got the point. Someone who watches his mouth, save his soul. I got the point. Someone who watches his tongue, save his soul. Also I got the point. Why double language? Because he's speaking about two different things. What is it, watch his piv, watch his mouth? Food, fressing non-stop like a pig all day. Everything he see, he must eat. Kosher, not kosher, he just finished eating another dessert and another meal and another one. And God forbid he missed one cake or one cookie over there in a wedding. The addiction to all this pleasure, what we call food. You see in America almost every other person is overweight, double or triple than what he should be. Look what's happening today in the modern society. People eat with all the surgery. All the gym and the training. Everyone is training. Everyone is going to gym. People have all this machinery in a home. And in the end, in reality, we're becoming heavier and heavier every month, more and more than before. Imagine if we wouldn't have all these gym accessories. And what's the second thing? Shomer leshono. Watch his mouth from speaking lashon hara. What goes into the mouth and what comes out of the mouth. That's the secret of life. That's it. This is this parasha, where the parasha speaks about the nation of Israel make a demonstration against Moshe Rabbeinu. What? What is this? You took us out of Egypt. We had watermelons, zucchini, eggplants, whatever. I don't remember the whole list. They give a list better than Italian or Chinese restaurant over there. And yet... We are talking, they were in Auschwitz. What did the Jews eat in Auschwitz? If they're lucky, one piece of bread a day. But in Egypt, now they remember the avatichim, watermelons. No, mamash great. They slaves in Egypt, they killed them with a whip, but they had time to eat watermelon, zucchini, all these things. Why you brought us here to the desert? Now everybody know that Hashem nominate Moshe to take them out of Egypt for a good reason. Nobody should have a doubt. The nation of Israel, they heard the voice of God giving Moshe the Torah. So everybody know we are heading to a good future. Well, fine, on a journey could be some hard days, maybe a hard week, maybe some shortage in the food. Fine, it can happen. But everybody understand, Hashem is watching us. We know it's all supervised. So they make a demonstration against Moshe that they want meat. I don't get it. They get man. Man, it's like a rain, snow. You get up in the morning, you have popcorn falling, and everything you are thinking about, you taste in a man. So you put a piece of popcorn in your mouth, what we call man, and you imagine a steak now, delicious steak. You feel a steak. You imagine Persian food. You have Persian food. You imagine Ashkenazi gefilte fish. You have gefilte fish. You want it Moroccan style? You have it Moroccan style. What do you complain about? So taste, they had the taste. The feeling of biting the meat, that's another desire. Just to play with your brain and imagine you eating steak and feel the taste, it's not enough. We want meat, they begin to scream. Rotzim basar. In case you didn't know, according to the Torah and Kabbalah, mainly Kabbalah, the Kabbalistic book teaching us a secret, that the evil inclination, that poison that we call Yetzer Hara, entered the body of the Jew through the meat. In case you didn't know. That's why the Kabbalists do not touch meat during the week, only on Shabbat. On Shabbat is lezorech mitzvah. It's mitzvah, the Yetzer Hara, the Satan cannot touch it. But during the week, it's 100% desire. There's no reason to eat meat so much. You can eat other things. Everyday meat? Must have meat. Cannot live without it. That's how the Yetzer Hara enters the body. So they scream, meat, meat, meat. Okay, Hashem say, no problem. I bring them birds. Slavim. Slav, I don't know exactly what kind of bird, because we don't have this kind of bird in the world. But I have to assume it's something like turkey. You know, when you eat massive turkey, it tastes like meat. It's very heavy meal, very heavy meal. So now they begin to eat meat, and they're falling and dying. So my biggest question, I don't know, I mean, if anybody can come up with an answer here. They are falling and dying, and the other people continue to eat. How can it be? If I just saw two Jews ate this meat, this shish kebab chicken, bird, whatever you want to call it, and they just fell and died, would I touch the food? I just saw someone ate it. Ah, delicious. Oh, 2 minutes later, he falls and dies. Ah, coincidence. Something happened, maybe heart attack. Doesn't have to be from the meat. The next one, he falls and dies. The next one falls and dies. How many more incidents you need to realize don't touch the meat? So there's all kinds of explanation. Maybe they were not dying right away. But the Torah say literally, while the meat was in between their teeth, as they're eating it, they're falling and dying. Cannot argue, it's a verse in the Torah. The desire is so strong sometime, nothing changed. People are like this till today. People are willing to enjoy 5 minutes and jeopardize their entire future, their family future, their children, grandchildren for eternity. For 5 minutes of stupid pleasure. And then when it happens to them, they got the sickness, they got the disease, then they sit and suffer for 40 years for their stupidity, but it's too late. Too late. Like one time, I don't know, maybe 12 years ago, one guy came to me and said he made a scene with some Hashem Yerachem Goya somewhere. And in the morning when he woke up, she wrote with her lipstick on a mirror, "Welcome to the club." I'm Evin Yavin. His life is ended. You understand what's going on today? So, they're eating the meat and they're dying. And what's the second sin we learn from this parasha? Lashon Hara. From who? Nevertheless, from Miriam the prophet. Now Miriam, besides the fact that she's a prophet, she has prophecy. Did she mean bad when she spoke against Moshe, or she meant well? First of all, she had a point. She had a point. Second, she loved Moshe. It's her younger brother. For sure, she didn't mean to hurt him. Right? And who did she speak about him to? She didn't come to the newspaper or to CNN to speak against her brother. She spoke to the other brother. Two brothers speaking Lashon Hara about the third one. It's all in a family. Rabbi, we don't get the dirty laundry out. We do everything, it's in our family. No, so what's the big deal? What happened to her? A very big embarrassment. A leprosy, tzarat. For a woman, such a thing. A rash all over the skin. First, it's insulting her in public. Hashem insulted her in public. Now everybody knows, wow, you spoke Lashon Hara. Nobody knows what she said. Everyone knows she's guilty of Lashon Hara. Who knows what she said? You know how people with their big mouth. You heard what happened to Miriam? Wow. Nobody knows that she said one word and she was right about it and it's only about, you know. If Miriam, that loved Moshe, she was a righteous woman, she was a holy prophet, she meant well, right? She got such a punishment, she had to be in jail for a week. What's going to happen to us? When we speak Lashon Hara, I promise you, we don't mean well. And when we see that our Lashon Hara helped, we feel even better. Oh, I destroyed him. Finally, my revenge is completed. Right? And we don't speak only against our brother and it stays in the family. We make sure as many more people who should know about it. And then we cry, why it happens to me? You know, two girls from a religious school, Bet Yaakov, in Israel, they sit on a bus and speak all gossip and Lashon Hara about the third friend of them from the class that she got engaged. How can it be she got engaged? What did he find in her, the guy? Is he blind? What? How did he choose her from all the options? What's wrong with this guy? I can't believe what's going on in this world today. You know, I wish his parents would know what problem they got themselves into. And they talk and talk, 20 minutes on a bus. Then the woman that sits behind them, she got up. And she said, wow, you just saved my life. They look, what happened? They say, you've been talking now for 20 minutes about my future daughter-in-law. You just saved me. I'm going right away to cancel this entire wedding. So right away they realize, wow, what we have done. No, wait, don't run. We can explain. No, what's to explain? I've been listening to you for 20 minutes. You expect me not to take a guy like this to my daughter? I mean, a daughter like this to my son? How can I do that? And no matter what you're going to say, you cannot fix it. No, we're begging you. It's really evilness. She's a great girl. We didn't mean. How can you make such a sharp turn? Right away, you made her a murderer. Now you made her a prophet. What's going on here? So, in the end, she wasn't the mother. But she decided to teach them a lesson. Yeah. But you know what it is? Sometimes a person doesn't realize the damage he makes until he sees it. But then it's too late to correct. Too late to correct. Then, another mystery in this parasha. Yehoshua ben Nun, which later will become the leader of Israel, not because he was the greatest rabbi. There are many like him or even greater than him, the Torah says. Moshe Rabbeinu's sons did not inherit him. All the other chachamim did not get the job. Who got the job? Yehoshua ben Nun. Why? Because he was fixing the benches inside the shul. When they go to pray, he used to put the chairs, fix, clean the shul. Since when a person become the leader of the nation of God because he knows how to clean the room? What does it show you? That the manners, the personality, the traits of a person is the most important thing. When you become a leader, Yeah, you can be charismatic, you're smart, you're rich, you have influence. Yeah, there are many people who have these skills. But how many people have anava, they're humble, down to earth, that they can hear the pain of every Jew, of every person who comes to complain about his problems? How many? Moshe had it. How? He was taking care of the sheep. One sheep ran, Moshe runs after him, he gives his heart to catch him and save his life. Hashem says, someone like this that care about a little goat, he deserves to be the leader of my nation. Yehoshua ben Nun, he cleaned the shoes, he respects me, he doesn't have ego, he deserves to be the leader. The Gemara say, Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel, the yeshiva of Shammai and the yeshiva of Hillel is full of legendary rabbis. Each one of them can revive the dead person from his grave. Each one of them. And Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel, whenever they have a philosophical argument, who wins the argument? Always Bet Hillel. Halacha like Bet Hillel. Does it mean that they're always right? No, that's not what it means. It just means that the law in Shulchan Aruch, the law in Gemara, and later in Shulchan Aruch, is always like Bet Hillel. Always. It cannot be that two legendary rabbis with their yeshiva arguing for 20, 30 years about thousands of topics, and one always win the arguments. Everybody understand that. Cannot be. It has to be 10, 20, 50% of the time that Bet Shammai also win the arguments. They were right. But doesn't matter. Automatically, always have to do like Bet Hillel. What is the answer? Why? Because they are humble. More humble. Not that Shammai is not humble. He's also very humble. But compared to Hillel, a little bit less. So Hillel and his yeshiva, they have better traits. They down to earth and they more humble. Thanks to that, the law is always like that. Excuse me. I understand. Very nice. I appreciate very much that Hillel is more humble than the yeshiva of Shammai. But since when we care about the truth, what's the truth has to do with being humbled? With modesty or things like this? You want to tell me he's a better person? Fine. You want to tell me he has greater midot? Fine. But what makes him right? I want to know which one is the right way to keep Shabbat. This way or this way? I want to know which one is more correct according to guy's eyes and opinion. Who cares his midot? It can be an Arab as far as I'm concerned. An Arab and a rabbi are arguing. And the goy was right. What's better, to do what the rabbi say just because he has a nice beard? Or to do what Ahmed say because that's the truth? That the answer is, Chazal told us, always accept the truth from the one who said it, doesn't matter who. Even a non-Jew, doesn't matter. That's the truth. You have to admit that that's the truth. In that case, please explain to me, why the Torah say the law is always like Bet Hillel? Why? Makes sense to you or no? The answer is, it can teach us a lot about life. When you are humble, when you are down to earth, when you feel like you're nothing, you're zero, you're nothing, doesn't matter how great you are, you feel you're nothing, Hashem will help you always, always, to get and to aim to the truth. Why? Because you consider yourself nothing. But if you consider yourself even 20%, 20% thanks to me, the rest is Hashem. 80% Hashem, I agree. But 20% is my charisma, is my sharp brain, is my efforts. You know how I kill myself in the Torah? You feel like this? No problem. 20% is you, only 80% from Hashem. But if you're zero, Hashem does everything for you. Same thing in wisdom, same thing in midot, same thing in parnasah, in making a living. If you throw everything on Hashem, He does everything for you. If you only throw 80% on Him, He will do 80% for you. If you throw only 10% on Him, He will do only 10% for you. That's how it is. So what's the best? Ashlech al Hashem yahavcha, throw everything on Hashem, the Torah say, והוא יחלק אליך, and he is going to feed you. Why do you have to worry? Like one guy came to me once and say, I have to leave the yeshiva. You have to leave the yeshiva? Why you have to leave the yeshiva? He said, well, you know, I'm already 24. I've been learning 2-3 years here. Baruch Hashem, I know a lot of Torah now. But one day I'm going to meet a girl. I have to get married. One day I'll have children. I don't have a dollar. What will I do? How am I going to buy a house ever? How am I going to buy a car even or a ring for the engagement? I don't have anything. I'm only learning. Baruch Hashem, everything I needed I have now, but it's not a point. I'm here in a school. They pay my expenses here. But one day I'm going to have to be on my own, no? So I better go find a job now, work 2-3 years, that when the time for me to get married will come, I'll have enough money to start. Right? 99.9% of the people in the world will say, smart guy, thinking about the future. Ezu hachacham haroe et hanolad, no? As a smart person who see the future, predict where we're heading to. So I told him, let me ask you a question. What makes you think that you're going to find a wife? Maybe you'll never find a wife. Say, don't say it. Well, I trust Hashem. I trust Hashem that I find a wife. I say, oh, you trust Hashem. Okay. What makes you think that you're going to have children? Many people found a wife and they cannot have children. What makes you think that you're going to have children? He said, what do you mean? I trust God to send me children. It's all emunah and bitachon in Hashem. I said, so you have trust in Hashem to find you a wife. You have trust in Hashem to give you children. But you don't trust Him to feed your children? What do you think? He's going to forget? He will help you to have a wife. He will help you to have children. And then He throw you on the street to freeze to death. That's how Hashem is. Well, I never thought of it. We trust Hashem with what's convenient. What's not convenient, we begin to have questions. I'm not sure. Hey, Ishtadlut, Rabbi. Hashem helps someone who wants to help himself. That's true. Many people replace confidence in Hashem with laziness. It looks exactly the same. Moshe, why are you not getting out of your bed? 1 week, all day you're in bed. Go to work, do something. 5-6 years, you don't work already. Why should I work? I trust Hashem, what? Sure, he trusts Hashem. He doesn't want to work, so he trusts Hashem. That's laziness. Someone like this, Hashem, is not so anxious to help. If I'm going to learn Torah, I sacrifice my days for the Torah, then Hashem will help. If Hashem see I'm real, if it's all beautiful speeches, we have trust in Hashem. If you trust Hashem, why you compare prices on Friday when you shopped for Shabbat? Why you check? Okay, this bread, $2.50. This one, $2.25. Okay, put this back, let's take this. Then you go here, $9.99, $7.99. No, put everything back, let's take from here, we save $7 we save. Why? Didn't you see that Hashem say, everything you buy for Shabbat, it's on my expense, I pay, it's on my credit card, you're not paying for it. Trust me. Don't worry, I reimburse you for everything. But I say to someone, you want to know if your chatan is a Baal Emunah? Send him shopping for Shabbat and follow him in a supermarket. If he comes and take everything he needs quickly and run to the register where the man is, not where the woman, then you already know two things about him. He really has trust in Hashem and in the Torah, and is an humble guy, and is modest. But if he compare for 3 hours prices, okay, he wastes Torah learning just to save $3. Then he came with a special coupon here, coupon there. You know, he drove 17 miles to save $3 on a coupon. Sometimes I go to Costco to shop for Shabbat. I see a person come, he buy 2 items. 2 items! Cucumbers! And, I don't know, lettuce, something. $7! He drove all the way here out of town to come to buy 2 items. Why? Because it's $1.50 cheaper than another store. You understand what's going on here? So, what's the story now with Eldad and Medad? Yoshua Ben Nun comes to Moshe Rabbeinu, and he say, put them in jail. What is this? Now they're receiving prophecy from Hashem. You are the prophet. So what is it like? You have the prime minister of Israel. He is in charge of making a decision, something in the Knesset. And now there are two Israelis calling Obama behind his back. Hey, Barack. How do you call Barack's sons in Hebrew? Barack Obama. How do you call his children? B'nai Barak. Anyway, so they call Obama and they say, hey, Barack, hey, don't worry. Even though Netanyahu said to you, no, we'll make it happen, don't worry. Oh, you're betraying the prime minister? So if he finds out, he gets very angry. He can fire them, can do something. Now, they're not doing anything against Moshe, but they're just receiving Nevuah now, prophecy. And Denar is the son of Moshe, according to one opinion, is Gershom. He runs to his father, Abba, there are two more Chachamim, you know, and they're receiving a prophecy from Hashem. And Yoshua ben Nun hears this, he says, put him in jail, quickly. I don't understand. First of all, is that a problem for two other people to receive a prophecy? What crime did they make? And if it's a problem, if it's not a problem, why Yoshua say to Moshe, put them in jail? Put them in jail, quickly. And Moshe say, are you jealous? Why are you jealous with them? Why should I put them in jail? I wish all the nation of Israel will be prophets. I don't get it. If you are a leader, everything in life has its own time. There's time to be humble and nice and to give up. And there is time you have to be tough. If now you are the leader and two people do whatever they want, they can jeopardize your position. You say something, they come and say something else and can create problems. No? If it's not a problem, why Yoshua ben Nun, that Hashem say he deserved to be the leader, wanted to put them in jail? Now I'm going to teach you a secret that most people don't know about it. It's a midrash that said that who was Eldad and Medad? The older brothers of Moshe Rabbeinu. That's why he's giving them extra respect. How they are his older brothers? We only know Moshe, Amram and Yocheved had three children. But Eldad and Medad are half-brothers of Moshe. How? When Paro made a decree for all the Jews to divorce their wives, he said, get divorced because they're going to kill our children. So what's the point of being married? Every boy who will be born, Paro will kill it. Better not to be together. Give your wife a get, finished. Then Miriam came to him and say, Abba, your decree is worse than Paro. Paro made a decree against all the boys. Your decree is against the boys and the girls. It's now it's not going to be any Jewish boys and no Jewish girls. At least we can have girls. Hopefully when there'll be boys in the future, we'll continue as a nation. But with you, in one generation, you cut us all out. He listened to her and he canceled his decree. But until it happened, Yocheved, his wife, he gave her a get. So he divorced his wife. That's before Moshe was born. So now she went and married Elitzapan ben Parnach. It's one of the holy people inside the Torah. You hear his name mentioned in the Torah. She married him for a short period of time. And she became pregnant and she gave birth to Eldad and Medad. Then when Amram canceled the decree, she went back, she divorced Elitzapan ben Parnach and went back to her original husband. You may ask, how can it be? The halacha is, if a woman got divorced from her husband, if she got married in between, that's it. She cannot go back ever to her ex-husband because she got married to another man. If she made a sin with another man, she can go back to her husband because she wasn't officially married to him. But if she got officially married to another man, then there's no chance that she can ever go back to her ex-husband. Never. But Amram is before Matan Torah. The Torah wasn't given yet. So it wasn't an official law yet. So it's still permitted. No, still very hard to understand, but still permitted. But now comes the next thing. Amram was Gdol Ador, the most important tzaddik, the most righteous Jew in the world at that time. How do I know? The Gemara say four people never made one sin in their entire life. Ever. Not even one sin. Never made one sin. Who are the four people? One, Amram, the father of Moshe, never made a sin in his whole life. One, Ishai, the father of King David, Ishai. One, Kilav, the son of David HaMelech. So his father and his son. And Binyamin, the son of Yaakov. Four never made one sin in their whole life. Amram was one of them. So Amram is a big chacham, big gadol ador. How his wife ignore his decree? He made a decree, no one should get married, no one should have children until Paro will change his mind. His wife got her get, ignoring him and going and getting married to somebody else. What's going on here? Don't ever forget, she was his aunt. She was his aunt. Amram Yocheved Dodato, his aunt. Now you ask me, how Amram marry his aunt? How can it be? The Torah says, Ervat Dodatcha lo tegale Dodatcha, you cannot marry your aunt. Again, that was before Matan Torah. By the way, that's one of the best proofs that Moshe Rabbeinu was a legitimate leader and everything he did is based on what Hashem told him and nothing from himself. How do we know? If Moshe, God forbid, was a faker, like some apikorsim are trying to claim, why would he come and bring a book from God and write in a book that you cannot be with your aunt if he knows that his parents are like this? Everyone who make a fake religion, he makes sure that this religion will not go against him, will not go against his parents, will not go against his own children, right? But the Torah says, "Va dodatcha lo tegale dodatchai." Amram and Yocheved, she is his aunt. So because she is the doda, you can tell your doda what to do. Sit and be quiet. So he didn't have the power to control her. She's his aunt. Same thing, Prophet Yirmiyahu, Jeremiah. In his generation, there was a female prophet. What was her name? Hulda. Hulda is one of the female prophets. There were seven female prophets. One of them is Hulda. Hulda was saying a prophecy when the prophet Yirmiyah, one of the strongest and biggest prophets we had, was alive in a generation. That's in the time of the destruction of the temple. Prophet Yirmiyahu. How Hulda speaks when there is a big Navi here? Imagine Rabbi Ovadia Yosef, he is the leader of a large community. Now comes a woman from somewhere. Hey, listen, I also have what to say. Kvod Rav, please have your seat. She begins to talk. What happened to the people on the street? Nobody would let her open her mouth. Huh? Rachel, the wife of Rabbi Akiva, when she came to welcome him after 24 years, they almost stoned her. The students. Where are you going? They were ready to send her nowhere. And Rabbi Akiva says, leave her alone. All our Torah belongs to her. She sent me to Yeshiva. I was a complete ignorant person, 40 years old. I'm 64 today and I know all this Torah. All of your Torah came thanks to her. But otherwise, she didn't even have permission to come near him. Nevertheless, to give a speech. Same thing, Hulda. She was a relative of Yirmiyahu. Ah, relative, it's hard already. That's what people tell me. Rabbi, I'm invited to a mixed wedding, mixed dancing. I say, not allowed to go. I say, well, how can it be? It's my cousin. My parents will get very offended. You know, it's in our family, we Persian, Bukharian, it's a dead sentence if you don't show up. You know, forget it, nobody will talk to me. My parents will get so embarrassed. Everything you are right. But you only forgot one thing. What do you prefer? That they will be satisfied and Hashem will cry? or they will be upset and Hashem will be happy? What do you prefer? That's always the question. You prefer to dance there? No, Rabbi, oh, God forbid, what do you think, I'm going to dance there? I'm sitting with my back to the band. On purpose, I'm in a corner, I ask them to put something that nobody sees me over there. And I promise you, I don't dance, I don't look at anything, I go, I sit there, yeah, baloney, all the ants coming, ah, Hamudi, come, 500 kisses, lipstick all over his face. He's lucky he has a beard, nobody can see it. All the Persian ants, no, I'm your aunt, don't worry, come. Rabbi, what? My aunt, she's 60, I'm 20, what? Come on, be logical. It's in our family. If you don't give your aunt a kiss, forget it. She's getting very, very upset. She raised me. She's like my second mother. Don't you think that when Hashem gave us the Torah, He knew all this scenario? He knew, or He didn't know? Well, He still said, not allowed. I remember I once went to San Diego. One of the leaders of the community over there got angry that I said to the people not to come to shul with a car on Shabbat. Say, one, we have one Sephardic minyan in the whole San Diego. We drive 45 minutes to show our kid a little bit Judaism, and now you tell us not to come with a car? So what do you want? That these kids will never see the Torah? So I asked him, oh, so he said, I'm sure Hashem will understand that we had no choice, we had to come with a car. So I told him, tell me, when Hashem gave the Torah 3,300 years ago, did He know that you and the people here would live in San Diego? Did He know there's going to be one Sephardic minyan and every Jew would live very far from it? Did He know or He didn't know? He said, yeah, He knew everything. I say, if He knew that it's going to be impossible to show up to minyan on Shabbat unless if you come with a car, why didn't He write in the Torah that in Shabbos there are two exceptions to the rule? One is Pikuach Nefesh, and one that the Jews can come to hear the prayer and the laning of the Torah. I never saw in the Torah that there is a second exception to the rule. Only one exception to the rule. Life risk. To come to pray, no permission to use the car. The same way He got up, He sat down, and the argument was over. Everyone bark and scream so much. Just use your head a little bit. Hashem knew it, yeah. You know, there'll be Jews all over. You know, they'll be far away from Torah, far away from the shul. They'll never hear anything. He knew. He did not allow it. That's all. I guess Shabbat is more important. If the prayer would be more important, like life, Shem say, Pikuach Nefesh is above everything. It postponed the Shabbat until the life risk is over. How long the life risk? 1 hour? Shabbat is on hold for 1 hour. 3 hours, Shabbat is on hold for 3 hours. Every Shabbat, Shabbat is on hold, forever. If you're a doctor, you deliver babies. Every time you walk on Shabbat, you do everything. You touch electric, you squeeze, you cut, you do so many things, what, to give birth. You can do 500 Chilulei Shabbat in one Shabbat when you work in a hospital. All of it is a mitzvah. Why? Pikuach nefesh doche Shabbat. It puts Shabbat on hold. If you're done with your last baby, that's it. Anyway, my whole Shabbat, there's music here in the hospital and news and television, and I was cutting and sewing and using fire or whatever. Okay, so let me have a cigarette. Now, my friend, only for Pikuach nefesh. Anyway, so the idea here is like this. Amram was Gdol Ador. Yocheved was his aunt. And Eldad and Medad are the older brothers of Moshe, and Moshe gave them respect. He's your older brother, not someone from the street. That's why Moshe cannot say anything. Otherwise, yes, Moshe is humbled. Moshe has no problem that everyone will be prophet, but there has to be only one leader. Every boat that has two captains will not get to his destination. He wants to go to Iran, he wants to go to Israel. Two different captains. Two drivers in a car. It cannot be. Unless if you're in a driving test.
But otherwise, you need one driver. It cannot be two drivers. He has his wheel and he has his wheel. He wants to go left, wants to go right. It's like Siamic twins. Two souls in one body. One wants to go to the bathroom, one wants to go to sleep. Right? Reuven and Shimon, two Siamic twins. One head on this shoulder, one head on this shoulder. Did you ever see that video? Two twins, one body, two heads. So they talk to each other. Hey, Reuven, I have to go to the bathroom. Off again. We just went 10 minutes ago. I'm sorry, we have to go, but I have only one set of legs. So now wants to use the legs. One brain wants to give an order to the legs to go to the bathroom, but the other one wants to go to bed. So now the legs are like this. It doesn't make a decision. Two captains on one boat. Why Hashem put two souls in one body? Could be a husband and wife that didn't respect each other in previous life. Now he was going to teach them a lesson. Not only you be together, you're going to depend one on each other. One wants to get married. The other one has to be under the chuppah. One wants to be in his wife to have children. The other one has to be there. Big problems in halacha. You know, the question is, they ask Shlomo HaMelech, one family had two heads with one body. And they came to the rabbi and said, Rabbi, our father left a lot of money. We want to get two parts of the inheritance. We have five brothers and us consider two. So we have to get two parts of the seven, not one. We are two people. So the other brother say, no, you are one person. What? It's go per body. Say, no, what? We are two people. We need to get double than everybody else. So what was the answer of Shlomo HaMelech? Spill hot water on the head of one, see if the other one scream I. If the other one scream I, that means they have one nerve system. The whole body is one, then we give them only one share. But the truth is that there are two souls there, two different souls. One of them came to Rebbe. One Rebbe thought he's a clown. So Rabbi, a person that had a Siamic twins, this is 2,000 years in the Gemara, this question. How many coins of silver he has to give to the Kohen in Pidyon HaBen? 5 or 10? Why? When you have your firstborn that came out of the womb, you have to give the Kohen 5 coins of silver. Let's say $100 today. You buy them in a store, 5 pure coins of silver. You come to the Kohen, you pay him. The Kohen release this firstborn from his position. What happened now if it's one body with two heads? Do you have to give him 5? Or it's considered 2? You got to give him double. So Rebbe thought, hey, this clown come to waste my time. So he told him, except on you to go to the exile. Leave the country. Cannot stay to live here in Israel. This man, he kicked him out. Then, a few hours later, a person came to him crying, Rabbi, don't ask, what? My wife gave birth to a baby with two heads. Now I have the Pidyon HaBen, I don't know how much to give the Kohen. So Rebbe saw, Hashem sent me this clown to ask me this question, to prepare me for such a complicated question. You understand? But things like this happen. Many interesting things happen, but anyway, we move on. I want to ask a question. When a person learns Torah, what does he get from the Torah? Pleasure or happiness?
Both.
First, can you tell me the difference? What's the difference between pleasure and happiness?
Both.
What's the difference between pleasure and happiness?
Pleasure is momentarily, it comes and goes. Happiness is for a long
happiness
time.
Also comes and goes. Person that won the lottery, today is very happy, tomorrow he goes back to his misery. Right? Person that heard the good news, your wife just gave birth. For 1 hour he's in the moon, 2 hours later he fights in a flea market with his competitors over there. He forgot about his happiness already. Yeah?
Maybe pleasure is for your soul and happiness is for your body.
If any, it's the opposite.
Okay.
No. So now I tell you why it's important to know. I tell you why. Because we have a rule. When we eat, everybody understands that when a person eats, he enjoys. Unless if he eats poison, right? But if he eats food, every taste, sweet, sour, spicy, people enjoy it. That's why people eat nonstop. We have a rule in the Torah, it's called Birkot Ane'enim. The blessing of the pleasure. The rule in this blessing is that when you eat, when you're going to enjoy, you make one blessing before and one blessing after. Right? One before, one after. You ate, you make Birkat HaMazon. You ate Mezonot, you make Al HaMichya. You drank good, something good, you make Borei Nefashot. You have a rule. Before and after. When you're going to learn Torah, you also have a blessing before. But you say it once in the morning for the entire day. Two blessings. Right? Am lamed Torah la'amo Israel. Bless you God that teach Torah to his nation Israel. And the second one, Asher bachar banu mikol ha'amim, chose us from all the nation and gave us the Torah. Baruch atah Hashem, noten ha'Torah. Bless you God who gave us the Torah. Two blessings every morning and then you can learn. Why there is no bracha achrona? Why there's no final blessing? You went to yeshiva, you learn until 1 o'clock, now it's 2 hours lunch break. You finished, like you ate now. You ate your meal, you make bracha. Tonight you're going to eat again. Doesn't matter. Right now I finish, I make bracha. Now I finish learning 3 hours, I make bracha, I'm supposed to make bracha again. Thank you for giving me the merit to learn Torah. And I finish, before and after. If learning Torah it's pleasure, then what's the difference between this pleasure and that pleasure? We always make a bracha on pleasure. If it's happiness, it's a different story. Maybe you don't need blessing after. But it gets even better. It gets even better. It says like this. The Gemara said there was a goy on Shabbat who lit fire for the Jews. Today we have electric, but in the old days they either had a torch or candles that gives them light. What's the halacha? If the goy turned the light for you, you sat in a dark room with a book in your hand, and the goy saw, you know, Chris was passing by, he saw a Jew with a yarmulke in a dark room trying to read. Goes like this, cannot read. The Chris came, enjoy Rabbi, and he left. Are you allowed to use this light on Shabbat or no? By the women, everything is allowed. By the way, sure, you're allowed. Yeah, well, you know why? Because they worry when they give birth, it will happen. And they go in, they're in a hospital, they're already preparing a medicine for. So the answer is really, you're not allowed. If they go, this is the halacha. The halacha is like this. Listen good. The halacha is that, listen good. It says like this. Asur le'enot mimelechet Shabbat sha'asa agoy avur Israel. Anything that the goy made specially for you, you're not allowed to enjoy on Shabbat. But let's say the goy hit water. You have a worker, she works for you for Shabbat. She's a goya, and she made herself tea now. She didn't make for you. She made for herself, and there's some left water, hot water in a pot. Since she made for herself, oh, you can use the rest of the water to make yourself now tea or coffee. Why? Because she didn't do it for you. But if she come to you, Senor, I'm making you tea. Not allowed to use whatever she prepared for you. What's the rule? Remember, not allowed to have pleasure from melacha of a goy in Shabbat that was done for a Jew. Pleasure, ana'ah. Now comes this argument. If learning Torah is pleasure, then if they turn the light for you, you're not allowed. But if it's happiness, then you're allowed. You understand how you have to know everything to define it correctly in order for you to know thousands of laws now are going to change to positive or negative if you know how to define things in life or not. If you define it correctly, everything, you know the truth. You made one mistake over here, it's a chain reaction. You make 3,000 sins because of that. So the answer is, it's happiness. So, it's happiness. That's one of the reasons, even though not everybody agree with that, that some make an argument that it's pleasure. Some say it's yes, for sure it's happiness, but it's also pleasure. What pleasure? Pleasure of the body? Pleasure of the body also. But להלכה we hold that it's שמחה. פיקודי השם ישרים מסמכי לב. The mitzvot of Hashem, the Torah of Hashem, mesameach, it makes a person happy. If a person is depressed, you put him in a Gemara class half an hour, you see how the light comes to his eyes. Forget about his tragedy. But later, when he closes the book, the depression returns right away. But as long as he was learning, it's like a tiger. Your business just collapsed. No, don't bother me now. I'm busy now. The answer is, in that case, according to the opinion that holds that learning Torah, it's pleasure, why don't we have to say a bracha after? They say it's pleasure, no? Like eating delicious cake. You make bracha after. Why don't we make a blessing when we finish learning? The answer is, because a person is always obligated to learn all his life. There is no end to it. From the minute you're born until you understand some words, your obligation to learn Torah never expires even a minute. Even a minute. Always. Even on Tisha B'Av, or even, God forbid, when you see Shiva, you're still obligated to learn. You're not obligated to learn happy things. You learn depressing things, the destruction of the temple, the laws of mournings, how you mourn if somebody died, where you rip the shirt, from the right, from the left, taking a shower, allowed, not allowed, what happened if you're a sinist, you're suffering from humidity, it drives you crazy, you're allowed maybe a cold shower, and you know, it's thousands of laws. When is the time to learn? Nobody likes to learn these laws, only unfortunately when it's too late. When, God forbid, the phone ring, and now they told you that, chas v'shalom, your father or your mother passed away, 99.9% of the people don't know what to do. Nothing. Not only they don't know what to do, even people who learn many years in yeshiva don't know it. Rav Ovadia Yosef say that one person called him to ask him questions about the law of mournings, and he knew that that's a sign from Shamayim, and a day or two after his wife passed away. Say, if this person, after a while that nobody asked me question about mornings, he asked me and looked for me so bad to ask me this question, that means they're preparing me from Shamayim that I have to refresh my memory, because nobody likes to learn these things. To refresh my memory, why? That when it happens to me, I know what to do. It doesn't matter, I can be the biggest chacham in the world, but this is something that nobody wants to learn because it brings bad luck. The Gemara says, there were three chachamim in a yeshiva. We almost done, a few more minutes. So, three chachamim. Rabbi Meir, Rabbi Natan, and the president of Israel. So now there are three. There's Av Beit Din. There is the chief of the chachamim. Av Beit Din is Rabbi Natan. Chief of the chachamim is Rabbi Meir. And the president of Israel, Rabban Gamliel. So now, The president saw that every time one of the three comes in, everybody rise. Let's say you have hundreds of people learning yeshiva. You walk in, everyone rise. The president say, it doesn't make sense. There are three levels here. There's the president, then there's the one who is in charge of the Jewish court, and then there is an official chacham that everybody respects because he's a giant. But it doesn't have an official position. So it has to be A, B, C. Has to be a difference. Why? Because when you give respect for the Torah, you cannot give respect to the biggest rabbi in the world as a rabbi who just became a rabbi 2 days ago. It's not fair. Why? This guy knows 1%, this guy knows 100%, and you treat them the same? That means the Torah is nothing for you. You don't have levels. When we come to respect the Torah, it's not what we feel in our heart. It's what Hashem wants. The more knowledgeable you are in Torah, the more respect Hashem wants you to give to the person. He doesn't want to give the same respect to someone 16 years old and someone 86. He learns 5 years and he learns 8 years. It's not going to be the same. So the president changed the law. He said from now on, when the president comes into the yeshiva, everyone rise. When the head of the court comes in, only the first row, where he walk in the aisle, from right and left, they will rise, the rest will sit and learn Torah. And when this Chacham, Rabbi Meir, comes in, only the first row rise, but they don't have to wait until he get on the stage to sit. As soon as he passed them, they can sit already. But when Rabbi Natan, the chief of the court, he comes in, they cannot sit until he takes his chair. Once he sits, this. So, they started to have an argument in the yeshiva if he made a proper decree. So what is this now? They're both three giant people in the Torah. How can you give one respect more to the other? So they started to make an argument. So the president saw that the students there are influenced by Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Natan, so he threw them out of the yeshiva. Imagine, two giant rabbis sit in the yeshiva. They're just as great as you in Torah, but you have the position. So you tell them, please, I'm asking you to leave. In a nice way, but leave the yeshiva. Why? You're making arguments here? Leave the yeshiva. So they sit outside, but now we're going to learn something great for our own personality. What would happen if one chief would throw the other two out of the yeshiva? What would happen? Right away they open the yeshiva across the street and begin fighting, which student is mine to come to me, no? What did they do? Standing like two little kids by the window and listening to all day what he's teaching. Well, but they cannot talk because they're outside. They cannot talk. So they write on a piece of paper questions and throw inside. And the people read and they ask him the questions. He answers to them and then they hear the answers. So they participate in the learning, but they're really outside. They don't have right to talk. So guess what? Then after that, the students started to say, Rabbi, how long are you going to keep the Torah outside on the street? We are inside the building and the Torah is on the street. Let the Torah come in. So he saw that the students are suffering from that. He said, okay, you come in. You come in. So you come in. So he said to them like this, okay, you come in, but I make a decree. Every time you ever say something in the Torah, no one will ever say it in your name. There is an obligation that whenever someone says something and you heard it from him, you must say, I heard from that rabbi. Until today, 2,000 years later, every place in the world you hear something in the name of Rabbi Meir and Rabbi Natan, you don't see their name in a Talmud. It's anonymously. That's why the Gemara always asks, who say it? Probably Rabbi Meir. Why? Because you don't mention his name. 2,000 years! Millions of Jews learn Torah. Nobody allowed to mention his name. Why? They didn't respect the president of the Torah enough. The Gemara say, listen good. One time, they prepare him a trap. They said, let's ask him questions about Masechet or Katzin. Nobody learns this Masechet. Nobody. It's like neglected subject. We will attack him with so much questions about it, he won't know the answer. Everybody will see that we are nothing less than him. So what happened? A student that heard the plan came to his window all night and started reading Masechet or Katzin loud. The difference between a Jew today to a Jew 2,000 years ago, if somebody stands by your window 1 o'clock at night and reads some kind of Mishnayot, today, wow, this annoying guy, let me throw something on his head, get him out of here. Hey, what are you, you crazy? Call 911, there's somebody crazy here, take him, I'm trying to sleep. He got the point. So if Hashem sent me this guy to read this to me right here, that means I got to learn it. He was sitting all night and preparing. Then when the next day they came to attack, he was ready. So I knew your plan. And that's when he made the decree. Now I want to tell you something interesting and we finish with that. The Gemara says, there's an argument between Bet Shammai and Bet Hillel. This is it. Tanu Rabbanan, היו יושבים בבית המדרש והביאו אור לפניהם. They sit, when is it? Motzei Shabbos. Shabbos is over, everyone is in yeshiva. Now they bring light, candle. Why? Because they have to do avdala. They have to do Baruch Ata Hashem Elokeinu Melech HaOlam Borei Meorei HaEsh. Why we bless on the candle on Saturday night? What's the connection between the candle and avdala? Havdalah means separating Shabbat from the weekdays. What does it have to do with fire? Because the first fire was created on Saturday night, Motzei Shabbat, by Adam. After Adam saw that yesterday Hashem took away the light, and then in the morning the light returned, that was his first day of his life, Shabbat. First day. It just was created before Friday, right? Then he made the scene a few minutes before Shabbat. Then after the scene, he saw it became dark. So he thought, oh, God is punishing me. Now everything will be black. Then after a few hours, he started to cry and ask Hashem to forgive him. Oh, the light came back. Oh, so quick, God forgive me. So great. Then again he saw dark. He realized, oh, it's not about reward and punishment. It's nature. So Hashem gave him some idea. He took some rocks and he made the first fire. That's why we say, Borei Meorei HaEsh. So now the Gemara says like this. They bring fire. Now, what is it? Does one person have to say bracha for everyone? Or every person should make his own bracha? Baruch Ata Hashem, Elokeinu Melech HaOlam, Borei Meorei HaEsh. And another one, and another one. What's the answer? Listen, listen good. It says like this. Bet Shammai Omrim, Kol Echad Mevarech Le'atzmo. Bet Shammai says, everyone make a bracha for himself. Bet Hillel say, one person make a bracha and has in mind to say it for everyone. They answer Amen, and that's it. This is what we do. Remember, everything like Bet Hillel. The Gemara says, what's the reason that Bet Shammai holds like this? Bet Hillel, I'm sorry. What's the reason Bet Hillel holds like this, that one does a bracha for everyone? Because they say, when many Jews make the mitzvah together, it's more honor for Hashem. It's called Berov Am Adrat Melech. You have 50 Jews here in this shul and 500 in this shul. If both shul are kosher, if one is not kosher, it's not even a dilemma. If both of them are kosher, nobody talks, the separation between the men and the women is kosher, etc., etc., then it's better to pray with the 500 than with the 50. Why? A larger group together, it's a higher level of a mitzvah. So Bet Shammai say, Bet Hillel say, one say, everyone together with him, it's a mitzvah of 500 people in one shot. Then each one a small mitzvah. So the Gemara say, okay, what's the reason of Bet Shammai? You're not going to believe it. They say, Mishum Bitul Torah, Bitul Bet HaMidrash. Why? How long does it take for a person to say a bracha and people answer Amen? 3 seconds? Today takes half a second. What? Finished. What? No, that's the way I say bracha. But in the old days, they Baruch Hashem, it took them 10 seconds. So the 10 seconds that it takes for a person to say one blessing, and everybody has to stop learning Torah, to listen to him until he say it, and then to answer Amen, this few seconds that you waste on the learning, few seconds on the learning, it's Bitul Torah. It's better everybody will say quietly to himself, that nobody has to stop, he's learning, and it's better. Why? 3 seconds! They'll learn Torah 3 seconds less! That's already a disaster, a tragedy. 3 seconds less. Like today, he learned 3 seconds, 3 hours play with his phone. 3 seconds less! You get it? You know, the Chafetz Chaim 100 years ago had a girl, 12 years old, that got a dibuk into her body. A soul of another man entered her body. Why? She drank water and she didn't make a bracha. Believe such a thing? And the book got into her. So they ask him, how did you have permission to enter the body of this 12 years old girl? He said, because I was right above her, and she drank water without making a bracha, and that thousandth of a second, I had permission to enter her body because of that. Then for 1 week, they were trying to get him out of her body, convincing him to leave her body. Now there's two souls in one body, like I said before, two captains in one boat. So they ask him, why are you so afraid of the Chafetz Chaim? Chafetz Chaim was the rabbi, and his student was Elchanan Wasserman, Hashem Yikom Damo, and a few students from the yeshiva. They ask question about the Chafetz Chaim. So he said, so they ask him, what do they respect the Chafetz Chaim in heaven the most? For what? He say, for his atmada in the Torah. For because he's very serious and devoting all his life for the learning of the Torah. He was a very perfect, righteous person. Never said one Lashon Hara in his mouth. The book didn't say anything about it. In a million years, we won't get to the level of the Chafetz Chaim in Lashon Hara, in behaving, in manners, in generosity, in being humble. So many things. I can give you 1,000 things about the Chafetz Chaim. Nobody in the world get to this level. But the book say one thing. Why they respect him so much in heaven? Because when every second of his life he give for the learning of Torah. He's very serious, persistent. Many people learn on and off, it's boiling water, taking it on, off, it will never boil. But when you are serious, devotion, persistence, then you grow to become somebody big. So they ask the Dibuk and he say, Chafetz Chaim, when Haman made a decree to kill all the Jews in Iran, in Shushan, Haman went to the yeshiva to look for Mordechai, to laugh at him. I won. All of you going to be killed. Here, I signed on the letter with the stamp of the king. He thought he'll find all the Jews crying in the yeshiva and learning the law of Kiddush Hashem, life risk, something that relates to the tragedy. The Midrash Rabbah say he found them learning Ilchot Omer. It was Tetzayin Benisan, one day after Pesach. And they're starting the counting of the Omer today. They were sitting in yeshiva as usual and learning the laws of the Omer when in few hours or in few days they always, every one of them going to be killed. Children, women, everyone. What are they doing? Learning as usual the laws of the Omer. You understand what it means? And Mordechai, what do we read about him in the Megillah in the end? Mordechai Ratzui Lerov Echav. Mordechai, he's appreciated by most of his brothers. Not all of them, most. The Gemara said, what do you mean? Such a righteous person that thanks to him saved the entire nation of Israel. How can it be one Jew has any minor problem with him? How? Thanks to him we're alive. Thanks to him going to the palace, Esther, King Achashverosh, he saved the life of Achashverosh. He was trying very hard, and he ended up saving all the Jews. How can it be? There's any Jew who doesn't kiss his hand and appreciate that thanks to you we are alive? The Gemara say Mordechai was one of the 71 members of the Sanhedrin, of the chief rabbi of the Jewish world. And the other 70 rabbis were upset at him. Why? He wastes too much time in politics. And he doesn't learn enough Torah. I promise he was learning Torah more than all of us together, 10 times more every day. All of us together, for sure. It was in a Sanhedrin. You don't make it to the Sanhedrin if you don't know the whole Torah by heart. But maybe half an hour a day he had to go to try to save the nation of Israel from a Holocaust. If the chief rabbi of Israel will leave the yeshiva and run to, I don't know, to Ahmadi and convince him not to dump an atomic bomb on Israel, and reach an agreement in the end. And thanks to him, all the Jews got saved. What would we say about that chief rabbi? That he's a hero, no? But the Chachamim say no, but he was learning a little bit less Torah. Torah is everything. once you already have to leave the Torah, it's a punishment. Even if you're going to save life, gadol talmud Torah yoter me'atzalat nefashot. Learning Torah is greater than saving life. You work for Atzala, every minute you save a person from death. You are nothing compared to a Jew who sits in yeshiva and learns that many Torah. That's what the Gemara says. Nobody understands it. Nobody believes in it. Nobody can digest it. But that's the Torah. I'm not making it up. Gadol Talmud Torah, the learning of the Torah, is much greater than saving life and definitely much greater than a wedding. You understand? So next time when there's a lecture, last time I was here, there were 300 people here. Today when I came, I don't think there was 50 people here today. Why is it wedding? Why wedding? Why wedding is so important? What, Moshe?
There's also another shiur.
Baruch Hashem, we found the greatest night. Baruch Hashem. But, Bezrat Hashem, everybody has to know the priorities. Wedding, yeah, go 7:30, 8, 8:15, say Mazal Tov. We appreciate, but we have learning. I told you once the story about the rabbi in Bnei Brak who teach every night group of people who goes to work. They come from work directly to the shiur, and he teach them from 8 to 9 every night the Daf Yomi, a page from the Gemara, every night. So he told them, tomorrow my daughter gets married. Don't come to the wedding before 9 o'clock. Do your shiur as usual and then come to the wedding. It's 2 blocks away. But don't cancel the shiur because of my daughter's wedding. Come after. Of course, no problem. But I won't be here. It's my daughter. 8:02, he shows up with his suit, everything, comes to the shiur. Rabbi, what happened? Your daughter, something happened? He said, no, I realize the rabbi is running late until the witness says with the ketubah, it's probably going to be 8:45 anyway. Let them wait for me 15 minutes. He started doing the shiur, 9 o'clock he went to his daughter Chatuna. That's a Jew that you have to stand online to ask a bracha from him. Not the ones you read in the newspapers about him. That's a person that appreciates the Torah. His daughter get married, he could have said, Hashem, Baruch Hashem, tonight I'm dismissed. Tonight, I have a reason. Tonight I don't have to worry. I'm not doing it for punishment, for reward. I cannot live without it. The appreciation to the Torah, yeah.
Two questions. First of all, what's the difference between happiness and pleasure?
Pleasure, it's pleasure of the body, such as eating, such as massage, such as some sports, such as anything that benefits the body. There's a few more things, I don't even want to say it. But you got the point. Any physical pleasure, it's called ana'a. But every pleasure to the soul, it's called simcha. Simcha. Simcha, it's a spiritual pleasure. Ana'a means physical pleasure. Every time you read in Shulchan Aruch or in the Gemara, ana'a, birkot ha-nehenim, nehene, ana'a, etc., etc., pleasure is talking about the body. That's why you say one bracha before and one after. You say bracha before, one after. But Torah, you're never full of it. You can never be full from the Torah. You ate a whole loaf of bread. You stuffed. You cannot breathe. So now you are full. Your body will continue to enjoy from it in the next few hours. So now after you finish eating, you make another bracha. It's pleasure of the body. But Torah? Who gave you permission to leave the Torah for one day? Read by the Rambam in the laws of learning Torah. A person connected to machines in a hospital. You cannot see his face. Machine, oxygen, all kinds of wires, infusia, whatever. He cannot move. But he is able to read. He still has to learn Torah. A person who runs from morning to night in the snow, knocking on doors, begging to get some money that he can feed his children, is not dismissed from learning Torah. A person is 120 years old. The doctors say, you have another hour to live. Still have an obligation to learn Torah. The learning of the Torah, it's like the obligation, lehavdil, of to eat. When you're sick, you stop eating? No, you have to eat. You don't eat, you die. When you depress, so you eat less or you eat more, depends. Some people when they depress they eat triple. Some people when they depress they give up the steak today. Rabbi, today I'm not in a mood for steak. Some people they depress right away, 5 potato chips bags, another 10 cans of tuna. Why are you eating so much? Depressed today. It depends. Everyone reacts differently to depression. Yeah.
What about King David? King David, he had to fight the wars. He had to learn. Later on, there was other kings who said, you know, I'm going to sing and then Hashem's going to come. Now I'm going to sing, Hashem's going to come. So last level, King David was the highest. What? It doesn't make sense.
What? What? I don't see where the contradiction
because
is.
Because King David went to go fight. The other kings, they said, I'm going to go sing.
Yeah, but we have a proof from the Torah that when the nation of Israel went to war, Moshe Rabbeinu started to pray. So Hashem told him, "Mati tzak elai, what are you praying now? Go to fight now." Whatever they did, according to the situation and according to the war and to the danger, when it's pikuach nefesh, the Torah says you have to go. I don't think you got the point. If you have to close the Gemara and go save life, you must do it. You don't say, what's the point? I'm missing 60,000 mitzvot going to save the life of a person who drowned in a lake. Let him drown. I don't want one mitzvah, 60,000. The Torah told you, pikuach nefesh is before everything, even learning Torah, pikuach nefesh. But you should know that it wasn't a reward for you, it was a punishment. That you are the one who had to go save him, and not your friend who sits over there, because you're sitting by the window and you saw the person drowning. Your friend sitting over there, he didn't see. If he would see, he would have to run. The fact that you feel great, wow, I saved life, don't be so happy. The 2 hours it took you to save life and take him to the hospital, it's 180,000 mitzvot you lost. For one. And each one of them, in heaven, it's greater than saving life. You have a choice? No. You must save life. If it takes to save life 50 hours in an operation and you like to learn Torah, you're not allowed. You have to fight for the person's life. If it takes a week, it takes a week. But it's not a reward for me that Hashem gave me. Why are you punishing me? I was learning. That means you're not satisfied for my learning. Maybe I'm not serious enough. Maybe I'm not on time. Maybe I don't put all my efforts. Maybe the business is more important for me. Maybe I'll learn only easy things. I know people. They sit in yeshiva and read Tehillim. Why? It's easy. They don't have to think. You understand? Or they hear Sipurei Tzadikim. 30 years he's in yeshiva, he knows every Sipur of Tzadikim, of every Tzadik who ever lived. But 2 lines in the Gemara he cannot explain. Why? It's hard. Gemara, it's hard. Sipurei Tzadikim, the Baba Sali went like this, the fire stopped. Very nice. In kindergarten, everyone loved it. He went like this, there's already a lake in Morocco, in the middle of the desert. 300 people drink from one bottle of arak. He covered it. Everyone loved it, of course. Go to the kids. Talk to them about Mishnah, talk to them about the story about Hocus Pocus. The kids, what do they want? Easy. So not good. We don't have to break our head. That's the nature of a person. Bezrat Hashem, next time, hopefully, you know, the Torah will come before any other party. Thank you very much. We'll see you again. Thank you.